kitchen next door so loud? First, I gotta apologize to things. One is I canceled the class last week. Okay, so as you know, my dad passed away, okay? And I got very confused for the past whole week. In fact, until now, I'm still very confused. Okay, I'm not. Of course, I'm sad, okay, but I feel I miss my dad. Okay, but I start to feel confused with what is the purpose of us coming to this world, that suddenly I need an answer. Anyone know answer? You give me an answer, okay? I really don't know why like that one. Maybe it's one stage of life, okay? I delayed today's class because I go for a general meeting, so I scared I can't rush back. Now, I took a photo to show you all as a proof. Can see me, that's me, alright, and that's the signboard. It's today's date, one, see that? 29th of October. So sorry, I delayed the class. So today we don't take break, study all the way until 9th from now. Okay, alright, now. Come back to this. So I'll discuss with you all the June 03 paper, which is the last exam paper, okay? So usually I'll do this in the last tutorial. So today is our last tutorial. Okay? Now, so this will show you the latest trend, how your examiner tested the paper. Last set, you say which page? Last set, last exam only. That means must be the last set, okay? Turn to page 110. Don't know which one last set, huh? I see. Again, 110, huh? Now, so this gives us a very good indication that the latest paper, how your examiner set the paper, okay? Now, I mean, I look at it, and I'm trying to use students' standard to look at the paper, and not my standard. I mean, if you say I look at the paper and say, easy, say, you're a lecturer, okay? But I look from, if I'm a student, I really find that the paper is pretty straightforward, okay? So if a student prepare well, I really don't see a reason why the student cannot get through. So that's why last round was okay, but the passing was not that bad. Okay, now, so we come back to this issue again. So we see what they want us to do here in the first question, the 30 marks. Now, examiners say that A, ISA 260, communicating with those charged with governance. Now, we learn this when we study which chapter, remember? Do you recall? No, you don't recall. Didn't prepare, that's why student didn't prepare how to pass, okay? Which chapter? We do this when we do reporting, okay? So during audit report, when I finish off the report, I also tell you that auditors also prepare management letter and give it to the management, give it to the directors, okay? Now, so that's the time I discuss together about ISA 260, okay? Now, so this standard says that auditors in relation to communicating with those charged with governance on matters arising on the audit. So now they ask, now why is it important that auditors communicate throughout the audit? Okay, why is it important that auditors communicate throughout the audit? Now, we are saying throughout the audit, that means you're looking at the beginning of the audit, during the audit, end of the audit. That means why must you have active communication? So why is it so important, okay? So why can't auditor just do audit without communicating? Why must you communicate? Now, I think even you think logically, you get the answers. Okay, you don't have to study, you can get an answer. Because, you know, you ask any layman that has some common sense, you ask them, why must auditor keep discussing with director? They can give you the answer. Okay, now number two, then they say give examples of three matters that auditors communicate to those charged with government. That's the one that you read from the theory. Okay, so the standards gave quite a number of lists. So there's 5 marks. Of, remember, I told you the questions always carry 5 marks theory, 5 marks theory. That's the 5 marks theory. Okay, now the second part is the case study. So let's solve the first part. Okay, A number one. Now, why is it important to communicate with those charged with governance? Okay. Now, see, we communicate with them beginning of the audit, during the audit, end of the audit, and there's so many things that we say that throughout the audit you must communicate. Okay, for example, we always tell you that you ask the directors about a lot of issues of the business, so we communicate to obtain an understanding of entity and its environment. Agree? Which is important for us to assess risk, right? Okay? Which is important to assessing risk of MM. Okay? Now you think and see, we discussed issue like fraud, okay, the last time. So we say we must go and ask the directors also whether they suspect if there's any fraud, okay, if there's alleged fraud. Example, okay. So communicating sometimes is important for us to know from the directors any key issue that we must focus at during the audit, okay. Now, to determine if there is any audit issue or significant matter affecting the audit. Okay, example, like maybe knowledge of fraud. Okay, it's probably the knowledge of fraud directors can tell you. Alright, now we also said before that during the audit there could be a lot of times you face problem with the management, and then you find if management is not cooperative, you can talk to the directors. So sometimes communicating is for us to convey to them our audit issues, okay, our problems, alright, to convey to them important matters like difficulties faced in audit. Okay, now financial reporting issues like compliance of your accounting standards. So we want them to know, we convey to them this kind of information so that as directors then they will know later when they want to do their work. Like for example, audit committee. I've told you many times that audit committee's job is to approve financial statement, recommend directors to approve financial statement. But before they can recommend, they themselves must review. But how can they review when they don't even know what is happening in their accounts? Okay, so that's why you think and see there's a lot of answers you can write here. It's pretty free and it's only like 2 marks. You just need 2 points. Okay, So examiner will mark 2 marks for you. Alright, so I've given you 3 over here. Okay, number 2. Okay, this is even more specific. We just want 3 examples. Okay? Now, any 3 examples that you communicate, anything, okay? Now, example, if you recall the notes, we say auditors will always communicate about your responsibility. So, one example is auditors' responsibility over the audit. Which is to express an opinion over the financial statement. Okay, that is the main thing that we're gonna do. So responsibilities is one. Okay, now what else that we will inform those charged with governance? For example, if there is any significant weaknesses in the internal control. Significant deficiencies in their internal control encountered by auditor during the audit. Now it has to be significant deficiency. So we're not very sure whether if examiner will tolerate if we just say weaknesses. Because the word weaknesses is very vague. Okay, we said before that significant deficiency is a technical term. Deficiency is defined in the standard, correct? Now? What is deficient? Deficient is defined in the standard as either absent of control. A control that is supposed to be there, but it's not there, is called deficient. The other one is the control is there, but it's not working properly. So that's where the lousy control comes in. So that's called deficient. And then what is significant deficient? Significant deficient refers to deficiencies that warrant attention of those charged with governance. So if you just say with weaknesses in internal control, then probably examiner will say that your answer is not clear enough. Because you're not going to tell them everything, right? So it's not all the weaknesses, it's significant deficiency. So that's why these are sometimes things that when you write, your understandings are not strong. Then you know something like that. But then you say, I write it, how come I didn't get marked? Because the wording make a lot different, okay? Now, so this is an example of significant deficiency. Now, other example include, for instance, like, the qualitative aspects of financial reporting. Like, for instance, the use by management of any inappropriate accounting policies. Okay, now if you have significant difficulties that you encountered during the audit, now for example, like management reluctant to grant access to information. Now I only need 3, I'm just giving you 4, okay? So I'm not encouraging you to write 4 answers in the exam, okay? Please don't. They ask for 3, you write 3, okay? So if you think you have 4-5 answers in your head, then you choose your best answer. You choose first, don't give them and let them choose, because you're not, okay? So it's better that you just give 3 your best answer, okay? And any point that you see you're not very clear, you try and give example. you get example and make the point clear. Follow, okay? Right, that's it. 5 marks. Very straightforward, Okay, now move on. Look at B here. Now this B is another very straightforward area, because the reason why it's easy is because of the way how examiners set the question nowadays. Now I'll tell you what is it, okay? Now examiners say that as part of the external auditors of Fox, write a report to management, in respect of purchasing and payment system described above, that you identify and explain four deficiencies, correct or not? And the possible implication and recommendation. Now this is examiner's favorite, right? Asking WCR, okay? Now the good thing is examiner said it. She wants four. That's it, she wants four, okay? And then she say a cover letter is required. Now a cover letter means one letter that goes with the report. That's called cover letter. The letter is a cover letter, you see, now? So it's not that you put the report in the letter. They just say, I want a covering letter. That means you write a report, but you write one letter that goes with the report. That's called a cover letter, you see, now? Okay? So you are not supposed to write a letter with WCR inside. You're supposed to write separately a letter and then goes with the report at the back. You see that? Okay? Now, they say up to 2 marks will be awarded within this requirement for the presentation, which means the examiner will give you 2 marks for the cover letter. Okay? And then after that, the remaining 12 marks is on the four weaknesses, which means 1 mark each. Okay? Now, so why is this requirement not difficult? Why is it easy? Now we read the case, then you understand why is it easy. Okay? Now they say that Fox manufactures engineering parts. It has one operating site and a customer base spread across Europe. Now the company's year end was 30th April 2013. Below is a description of the purchasing and payment system. Okay. Purchasing system. Now, whenever production materials are required, the relevant department sends a requisition form to the ordering department. Now, an order clerk raises a purchase order and contacts a number of suppliers to see which can dispatch the goods first. This supplier is then chosen. The order clerk sends out the purchase order, and this is not sequentially numbered, and only orders above 5,000 require authorization. Well, I think until now itself, you already see a few weaknesses, right? An examiner just wants four only one. Now, how difficult can that be? Now, for example, you simply choose supplier that you think who can send the fastest, you choose that one. Correct. Now, how can it be like that? In a proper system, I've told you all before, right, when we discuss internal control, you must have an authorized supplier database. You will then choose from the database whichever one that fits your criteria. And not like this, that the clerk simply choose one supplier. Because, you know? Now, then number two, they say that the clerk will send out the purchase order which is not sequentially pre-numbered, which is a very big problem, right? You got no number how to keep track of which is a PO. Then number three, only 5,000 needs authorization. That means anything less than 5,000 don't need to authorize. Then you can buy anything, right? Now there's three problems in my hand already. Before I continue reading, I got three problems. Then I read one more, I can finish a question. Then I don't have to read the whole thing. I can answer it. Yes, you know? So that is the current trend of your examiner. She's actually very nice. Okay, this examiner is very, very nice. She always give a lot of problem, so that you have endless possibility in the answer. You can have a lot of choices, yes, you know? So please go for those obvious ones. But some students, very strange one. They like to look for things that is very, very hard for other people to see. One. For example, their student will say that the requisition form maybe got no authorization. I say, how do you know? Because they never say. I never say, you assume. If examiner want to say no authorization, examiner would have said for you, right? For example, examiner say the PO will not authorize if it's less than 5,000. So why write something that you're not even sure when there's something more obvious there? You understand? Okay, so please, you must write something which is very clear so that there's no doubt to your answer. Follow, okay? Now, so I think probably we have 3 points that we can use now. So 1 point here. Okay, the other point is the sequential numbering, 5,000 of 3 answer. Okay, now go on. Now the purchase invoices input daily by the purchase ledger clerk who has been in the role for many years and as an experienced team member, he does not apply any application control over input process. So application control, we just learned this the last class. What is application control again? Control over input processing, output. That's for IT system, correct? Application control, check digit, format check, range check, completeness check. This is called application control. So that means that when the input, the system inputs straight away without any application control, okay? Now every week without application control, that's a problem with you, right? Okay? Now every week, the purchase day book automatically updates the purchase ledger. And this ledger is then posted manually to the general ledger by purchase ledger account. Okay. Now, the thing is automated at the beginning, but manual at the end. You don't feel very strange when you got things like that one. You want either all auto or manual. Okay, all manual because you got no system. Now you got system, but the system is half. So it sounds strange. It's like you stay in a condo. That the condo got 7 stories, the lift reach 3rd floor, then you come up, you walk all the way up. Then why not you build a lift all the way up? You see, no? So the idea is like that. So you look at this question, the style is like that one, okay? Now there's another problem. Now, payment. Folks maintain a current account and a number of saving account. Current account is reconciled weekly, but the saving account are only reconciled every 2 months. Which obviously is something very funny also, right? Just like the manual and auto. One you do it auto, one do manual. Then one you reconcile every week. One you reconcile every two months. Then what significance is that? Why not reconcile everything every month? So why must be one is 2 weeks, one is 2 months? What's so special here? You see, now, so it's so obvious, something is wrong, okay? Now, in order to maximize their cash and bank balance, Fox has a policy of delaying payment to supplier for as long as possible. And suppliers are paid by bank transfer. Now the finance director is given the total amount of payment list, which he authorizes and then processes the bank statement. You see not? Okay? The bank payment. Now that's the another issue. Management wise that delaying payment to supplier is not a very good practice. Because you're not, okay? Now, so these are all the issue, but we only need 4 witnesses. Okay, so first of all, you must have a covering letter, okay? Now, the important thing the examiner is going to see now in the covering letter is what? Part B. Okay. Cover letter. Now when it comes to formatting of a letter, you realize that the way UK people write letter is very different with our letter. They always write letter that the address start on the right hand side, okay? But we know that a formal letter, the address always start on the left hand side, okay? But I don't see that's an issue, okay? So as long as the thing is you address correctly. Now who are you? You are the external auditor, right? Okay, so you probably have a name for yourself, all right? Because they never identify your name. Maybe you can put XYZ Associates, because you know, just put a name, all right? All right, so maybe I put James Joyce and Associate. Now put your address. Okay, so in exam, just write something in, and please don't spend 5 minutes to think what address is nice. What road do I use? Please lah, okay? Address only, no marks one. Just simply write something, okay? So just put number 4, K, Okay, maybe you just put a street. You don't know what street, simply put a Malaysian street because you're not used college bandar address. Now, after you put it in, okay, now we have our client. Now, who is our client? That one is very particular. Who are you writing to? Fox, because you're not, okay? Now, so today is 29. You're writing to Fox Industry Co. And then you put in the address, okay? Okay, to their board directors, right? Board of directors or members of the board, lah, huh? Okay, members of the board. Okay, so this is the management letter that covering significant deficiencies of their internal control. So the significant deficiencies over your purchasing and payment system. Highlighted in your April 13 audit. Okay, now just put very simple issues to finish off because you just get 2 marks. Okay, now we can just say that as part of our normal audit practice, we would like to highlight in our report as attached the significant deficiencies identified by us while assessing your purchasing and payment system. Now, the auditing standard say there's a few things you must inform them. You must tell them the objective. Okay, you must tell them that this is only for you. Okay, we don't tell people outside. So all these things you can tell. Okay, now maybe you can just include that. These are matters encountered during the audit and it does not encompass a detailed review of all aspects of your system. That means we imply maybe there are more problem, right? So that's why we just say that we only encountered this in the audit. Okay. The audit is conducted with an objective to express an opinion whether financial statement give true and fair view. Now, the matters dealt in the attached report is exclusive the use of the management and must not be disclosed. External party without our written consent. Okay, that's it. So, thank you. Yours, faithfully, then you sign. Alright? Now, it's meant to be a covering letter. Now, of course, you know that when we study, we don't use a cover letter. We are doing it in the letter. That's why we usually straight away put it inside the letter, what are the issue, alright? But since examiner said I want you to prepare a cover letter, you prepare a cover letter, okay? But I can't just write everything inside, because if you follow exactly what the standard tells you, there's a lot of things you must say, okay? Now, but just that, it's only 2 marks. You want to give mark for format, you want to give mark for content. If I write everything in, then I will not have enough time, okay? So I just write the main thing. I just mentioned that these are all the problems that I come across during my audit. You might have more problems. I mentioned about objective of the audit. I mentioned about your exclusive use. You must not disclose. Enough, okay? More than enough point. Alright, so now we go on and prepare the report, which will come as an appendix. Okay, so there's an appendix. Report on the significant deficiency, not the same thing, deficiencies over your purchasing and payment system. Now, we present answer in the table. Always like that. Okay, every time examiner asks WCR, your answer will always be presented in a table with 3 columns that you must give them the deficiency, the implication or the consequences, and you give a recommendation how do you alleviate the problem. Okay, so I will just pick the first 4 problems I see from the beginning. Now, first of all, they say the club can raise purchase order from whichever supplier the club sees fit. Okay? The order club can raise purchase order with whichever supplier that the club sees fit based on the fastest as the only criteria. Agree, right? Because the club use the fastest delivery as the only criteria. Now, of course, my view is, number one, you don't just evaluate criteria based on the delivery speed. There could be a lot of other issues, okay? Now, if you think delivery is an issue, you think and see, if you think logically, if delivery is really an issue, then you can always solve the problem by ordering early, right? There's like in management accounting, you learn what? In those low level, you learn reorder level. Correct, huh? Then you look at what your maximum usage, maximum lead time. So you order early, you solve the problem. There could be other more important issues like pricing, okay, like quality. So this is one issue that we see here that is not right. Okay, see, huh? Now, so fast delivery should not be the sole factor, since other important criteria like pricing, quality, shall be conceded to. Now, but anyway, this approach allows other club to buy from inappropriate supplier, causing Fox to pay for uncompetitive price. That's the problem that we see.
Okay, so if the club simply said, oh, the guy very fast or very expensive, then you have a problem that you're going to end up paying more.
So how do you solve the problem? Now, the way to solve the problem is very simple. You should come up with an authorized suppliers database that you don't have the freedom of choice to decide anyone you like. Okay, so you're not, okay? So Fox shall establish an authorized supplier database where other club can only place order with them and which is after being evaluated thoroughly before they are being registered as an authorized supplier.
So that will make sure you are safer, that no matter who you buy, at least you don't have to feel worried.
Okay, so this is the issue that we see here. Now then, number two, now they tell us that the PO is not sequentially numbered. Now, purchase orders are not being sequentially numbered.
That's it. That's the problem. Okay, so it's short and simple, but one mark. Okay? One mark. You get one mark. Okay.
Now, what else can you say? Is that's it, lah? That's the problem. Okay, that PO are not being sequentially pre-numbered. So what's the problem when your PO is not being sequentially pre-numbered? You find that it's very difficult for us to trace if there's anything missing. Okay? Now, this will be very difficult for any missing PO to be traced, since gaps cannot be identified.
Okay, so the purpose of sequential number is for us to see a jump in the number. The gaps is what we need.
So now you can't find the gaps in it. There's no number. Then number two, the number must be pre-numbered, the document must be pre-numbered, because we don't want you to throw away and issue a new one. Now anyone can issue a PO and then replace back one, because there's no number. Is it not? So no number means there's no identity. So once there's no identity, it can be fake one, is it not? So that's why it will become easier for them to commit fraud. Okay? So it is also easier for the purchasing staff to issue a fictitious PO to replace with a genuine one. Okay? And why? Probably for fraud purpose, collusion with supplier. Maybe a process at time you show the amount is $2,000. But then after that, buy already, you take out the PO, you replace back, put $2,300 and let the account process and pay higher to the supplier. Anything is possible, right? So this is the problem. So the way to solve this problem is very simple, right? That all purchase order must be given. Sequential number in advance. Okay? So there must be sequential pre-numbering. You give the number in advance. Okay? Now then, the purpose once you introduce a number is you want to keep track if there's anything missing. So that's why there shall be regular checks to detect gap in the sequential number. So that may indicate that document is missing. So you must do that regularly. Okay, this is number two. Now number three, the issue of the PO not being authorized. Now this is also very obvious. They say that purchase order below the value of 5,000 are not subject to authorization.
That means the clerk is the one who authorized the order,
because the clerk can simply process one, can see not? So it's by the clerk himself. Now, this could result in inappropriate purchase being made. Example, at uncompetitive prices, or the worst is what, the clerk can buy things for himself, right? Okay, or the order clerk can abuse his power to make fraudulent private purchases. Okay? Because 5,000 is not a small amount anyway.
Correct. So you can see that for a clerk, 5,000 can be big. So you can still use his power to simply buy things for himself. Okay?
So this is a big problem that we have here, which encourage fraud. So in that case, we find that what you must do is you need an authorization. Okay? Now, so authorization must be required for all PO. Okay, but maybe you can consider that if all this small amount is a lot, you may not need a manager. Then probably you have you assign power at different level. Can see not? Okay, now Fox may consider assigning the authorization power to various level of management depending on the value of purchase. Now for example, we can just suggest lah, maybe for PO below 5K to be authorized by the assistant purchasing manager. Now we don't know they have it or not, but end of the day you have your freedom to write the answer, right? So you just assume that if they have it lah, then this is what you can do. Okay, right, so three problems. Okay, last one, they mentioned that input of the invoices is without any application control. So if you want, you can write on that one. Okay, this is number four. Last one. Now the input of purchase invoices by purchase ledger clerk is without operating any application control. Okay, so it comes with no application control. Now, input application control is important to ensure accuracy of the input value into the purchasing system. Hence, faults has higher risk of processing purchase invoices inaccurately. So that's the problem that we see. So if you find that this is important, then what you should do now is you probably can implement control. Because you know, so maybe the purchasing system shall be updated with relevant input checks to detect invalid values being input into the system. Okay? Right, that's it. Okay, so this part B. Now, can we move on and look at what they ask now in part C over here? Now they ask for four application control that should be adopted by Fox Industry to ensure completeness and accuracy of the input of purchase invoices. Now you just give any four control. Okay, any four control. Now we say that when you talk about input application control, like if you remember the grouping, we mentioned there are two. One is called verification control. One is called validation control. Right? Not? Now what is verification? Verification is you verify what you put in is the same as the source. So that's called verification control. Now the easiest way of verification control is what? Is we say use your eyes and check. Okay? So for example, you look at the invoice. So after you key in the supplier's account number, then you must check the name that the supplier appear in the system is the same name as the invoice. Now, this example of what you do, because you're not okay? picked up. So part C, okay, application control. Now one, verification control by way of eyes inspection, where club shall manually read the value he input into the system again to confirm that values are consistent with the purchase invoice. Okay, example. Now, just like I say, you can verify the name of the supplier. Now, there's a lot of things you verify. For example, the purchase amount. Okay? The amount of the purchase. You key in the amount, you must look at the invoice again and see you key in the right amount. Okay? So this is verification control. Okay, this is one of these. Now, number two. Now, you start to introduce checks. Okay, there's so many types of checks that we have, right? So you can talk about different types of checks. Now, what kind of checks that do you need? Okay, for example, you may look at reasonableness or range checks. Okay, so anything that you believe is that's a range or there's a value that you need to check, you can check. For example, maybe purchase amount. Because normally you know that the amount you buy must be within a certain average. So if it's above the average or below the average, it can appear to you unusual. Like suddenly, I always buy something around 2,000 to 5,000. I want to enter invoice value is 50,000. That's something very strange, because normally you don't do that, because you know. So that's why in that case we can confirm again whether the number is correct or not. Okay. Now, for example, the system can monitor if the purchase value is significantly higher or lower than the threshold. But that's you define. Okay, how much you define. Okay, so the system can monitor if it's significantly higher or lower than threshold, then a message is displayed to prompt the club to reconfirm accuracy of the value. Completeness check, which is very important, right? So system shall check if all required values are entered before processing the purchase invoices. Now, for example, maybe your supplier's code maybe is credit term, etc. Because once your value is being left out, then later if there's anything you can't, you will have incomplete records. So that's why make sure that everything is in. Okay, now number four. Now you may have, for example, existence check. Okay, that maybe all the purchase invoices processed into the system must belong to registered authorized supplier in the standing data file. So a check by the system to ensure that there is a valid supplier. So that's existence check, okay? Right, that's part C. So this is the issues that we see here. A bit of computer. Just give four checks. Okay, four checks, four control that you think is relevant, that you can introduce them into your invoice processing. You get 4 marks already. But you cannot just write there completeness check and then don't write anything. Then sorry, examiner may not give marks to you, considering you never explain. Okay. So but if she's nine, maybe she might give you 0.5 marks, so I don't know. Okay? So this is up to her discretion on how they decide on the marking. Okay, now this is C. Okay, D, now they ask us, describe the substantive procedure that you need to perform on both bank and cash. Okay, so it's two things. You're going to audit bank and cash balance. Now, we are talking about the bank and cash balance. Okay. So if it's about the bank and cash balance, so anything that concerns the balance is also the right procedure. Okay. Now, so if you recall the understanding when we audit bank and cash, we told you that in the book, your balance should made up with money in the bank and the physical cash. Now, money in the bank, usually you will know from the bank statement. Fair enough? And the bank statement usually may not be the same with the balance you have in the record. So that's why we need to do a bank recon. So the audit will involve audit of bank recon. Now then when you want to know the cash, what we do is you do a cash count. So your answer is to write everything that we see here. 7 marks, you write 17. Actually, it's much more than 7 points you can write here. Okay. So that's why it's not difficult also for you to score over here. Okay. So example, the 7 things that we're gonna see. Okay, audit of bank and cash. Okay. Number one. So if you're going to audit bank recon, what do you do? Okay, obtain a bank reconciliation. Okay, for April 2013. The question's year end is April 2013, right? Okay, so obtain a bank reconciliation for April 2013. Confirm that arithmetically it is correct by casting the bank record. So the bank recon must be correctly prepared, right? So you cast, see whether you add minus correctly. Then the next thing is what? Okay, the amount you see, the total, the balance, come from where? The balance per statement come from statement, right? So you should then agree the balance per the bank statement to an original bank statement. There's another procedure here, okay? Now, the bank statement is one issue. And normally, besides doing bank statement, we tell you that there's also a bank confirmation. So when you do a bank confirmation, the bank confirmation also carry the amount. So that's why you should also agree to the bank confirmation. Now, you should also agree the balance per the statement to the reply from bank via bank confirmation. Now you do, you don't do, it doesn't matter. Because in the exam, this is a valid answer because it's one of the possible procedures that maybe you have done a confirmation. So you don't have to worry about what if they don't do. It's okay, it doesn't matter. You just write anything that you can do. Also correct one. You do or don't do, also never mind. You just write because this is one of the possible way of what you do. Okay, number four, that we should agree the balance per cash book to Fox cash book and you cast it. Okay? See, just a standard procedure already 4 points. Before even we start discussing the detail work inside. Can you see that? Okay, now we know if there is an uncredited deposit. Okay, for the list of uncredited deposit in the bank record, agree to May 13th bank statement. I just write short form, okay? Agree to May 13th bank statement to confirm that they have been credited. So once credited, then this is a real thing. Okay, number six. Now we also mentioned before that if the uncredited deposit takes a long time or delay, you may want to inquire and find out why. Okay, so identify if there is any unusual delay for deposit to be credited and inquire management for reason for such delay. Okay, just find out why is there a delay. Okay, number seven, for the list of unpresented checks in the bank record, agree to May 13 bank statement that checks are presented. Okay, now you might have a lot of unpresented checks that you had in the past. Okay, that is still unpresented, maybe until now. So if that's the case, you may want to consider reverse them, right? Because you know, so if there's any long outstanding unpresented checks, okay, that the validity has expired. Okay, checks may be issued valid for 6 months, valid for 3 months. So you just look at the validity period. So if the period expired, then this cannot be a payment already. You have to reverse it. Okay, then ensure that management has made reversing entry into the account.
Okay, so 8 points already, right?
More than enough already, right? Before I talk about cash also. So if you think in the exam you got that enough answer, you stop, right? Okay, you don't have to say that, hey, I have not touched on the cash also, you know, it's okay. Because the marking allocation is, we always give you more marks that you can get. So the answer the examiner give you can be maybe for 12 marks, 10 marks, but you only get maximum 7. So that's why you run until enough, you stop. Huh? Okay? So if you talk about audit cash, then you talk about how to do cash count.
And then to do cash count alone, there's so many things to consider, right? That you must do on a surprise basis, you must count with them. After you count, you must record the amount, get them to acknowledge. So all these are the answers you can write here, okay?
So plenty, huh? That's the audit of bank and cash. So that's 30 mark, done already, huh? Not very difficult, right? Okay, now look at question 2.
Now the requirement is list 5 ethical threats to independence and objectivity,
and for each threat identify one example that may create the threat. Now the examiner say list only, you don't have to explain, you just list. Okay, that means you state only what threat, finish, and then you just give example. So there's a very, very easy 5 marks also, okay? Now then B, in accordance with ISA 570 going concern, what are the responsibilities of auditor and management? Now there are 2 parts. We're talking about auditor and management, okay? So you must write both. Now what is the content of emphasis of method?
So that's why we say that when you write emphasis of method, you must remember what are the 4 requirements. Okay, in the 4 requirements, you know the content. You must have the keyword, refer to the note, fair enough. Now, we mentioned that it's not being qualified. The position is not the content. Okay, so that one is okay. But you know what are the requirements. Okay, what are the content over here.
Okay. So first of all, question 2A. Okay, ethical threat. So what threat do you have? Sell interest. That's it.
Now, listed. You just listed. Don't need to say what's the meaning. It's another list only. No list and explain. Is it not? Or briefly describe is different. A list is the same as a state. State. Okay?
So sell interest. Example. Earning excessive fees from your audit client. Done. Okay, lagi. Self review. So example of self review is like what? Providing non-audit services to audit client. Hey, why you bring birds into class? Wow, that's a big poo bird. Okay, now providing non-audit services to audit client where the non audit work are subsequently subject to audit evaluation,
because you must evaluate back the work you did. So the self-review trend.
Okay, number 3, what else? Intimidation.
So give example of intimidation.
Okay. Example is the client threatened to what? To remove you, for example. Okay? That management threatens to remove auditor. Okay, that's intimidation. What else? Okay, familiarity. So familiarity arises because of what? Relationship. Okay, which can have many types, right? For example, having a long association with your audit client, because being engaged for too many years
will give rise to familiarity. That's why we said before, right, that if you audit PLC, you practice rotation. And one last one is what?
Advocacy threat. So how does advocacy threat arises? For example, promoting share. So promoting shares of the client for a listing exercise.
Right? 5 months. Well, that wouldn't be very difficult, okay?
Now, B. Now, they ask us two issues.
So what is management responsibilities when it comes to going concern?
Management will be the one doing the assessment, right now? They will decide if the company is going concern so that they can use going concern. So that's why in this case, management shall assess if it is appropriate to use going concern basis and then prepare financial statement. Based on the appropriate assumption according to their assessment made. Now, that's what management do, right? Management will assess and then decide. If the basis is appropriate, then management will use the basis and prepare their account. So this is management's responsibility. Okay, what about auditor's responsibility? Now, if you recall the note when we learn going concern, I discussed with you in the ISA, the first part is the responsibility. So what is auditor's responsibility? Now, first, you must get evidence. That's your job, okay? So number one, to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence about appropriateness of management use of going concern assumption. Now,
getting evidence is about doing the job. Okay, that's to get the evidence. Now, once you get the evidence, you make conclusion. Okay, you make conclusion.
So, to make conclusion if there is any uncertainty over the entity's going concern. And the conclusion you make will affect the report. Correct? Right? That's why we always tell you that at the end of the going concern, you must decide how to report. So that's where we consider if going concern is appropriate, if going concern is uncertain, if going concern is not appropriate, there are different types of opinion and different ways of modification. So that's why the third responsibility is to consider the implication to the auditor's report based on the conclusion reached. Now it's just 3 marks, actually.
We have 4 things here, but the standard of 3 responsibility for auditor. Okay, so these are the 3 responsibility.
Now you study, then only you know. You don't study, you don't know. These are things cannot bluff. Okay, you write something else, sure no marks, because it's based on the standard. Okay, now see. Okay, what's the content of emphasis of matter? So the 4 requirement says position, which is immediately after opinion. Okay, that one is okay lah. Okay, it's not a content. All right. Now then they mention about a heading. Okay. Then they mention about a note. They mention that it's not qualified. So that's why the content of emphasis of matter is to indicate where in the financial statement that user can read the disclosure on the matter that auditor has emphasized on. So there's one thing you normally say. Then number 2, to indicate that opinion is not being qualified on such matter that auditor has emphasized on.
Now, so if you read and remember the 4 requirements of EOF, you got the answer. Because position, heading, note, and the keyword. Okay? 14, that's the 2 things that will form under the content. Right, that's 10 marks. Done. Okay, so this is question 2. Okay, can we turn to question 3?
Case study in part B, 15 marks comes in. Alright, now we look at the theory. Okay, explain the concepts of materiality and performance materiality. So this is exactly a repeated question. Examiner asked this before. She just repeat the same question. So if you are hardworking enough to do pass here, you will say, hey, I see this before, okay? So this is also a very good news for us. She repeats.
the style of this question is so similar to one of the questions she did before, okay? So that's why it's a good news for us. So you should focus more on the past year, okay? Now, so question 3A. First, now they ask us to talk about materiality. So obviously, we must start defining, right? So that's the first thing. Okay, now what is materiality? Materiality is the measure of the significance of a matter in the financial statement to users of financial statement. It's a measure of the significant. And how do you measure if something is material? That's what we say in the standard, right? That a matter is material when its omission or misstatement can influence economic decision of the user. So define it, lah. So you got materiality, okay? Okay, so once you got materiality, then you must also understand that when we talk about what is material, how do you assess? Material or not material is always a matter of what? Judgment. Okay? If you recall the class when we discussed materiality, I highlighted to you. Okay? It's very important to remember what is material or not is always a matter of professional judgment. Okay? So, materiality is a matter of professional judgment. Now, no doubt there is a matter of professional judgment. We also say that we try to narrow down the assessment by dividing materiality into two types, which is qualitative and quantitative. You got amount, you got nature. So you must say that, because you're not, okay? Now, can be measured quantitatively and qualitatively. Okay, so to measure materiality quantitatively, then what do? Then you will start at planning stage, correct or not? Okay, so during audit planning, auditor shall first assess the financial statement materiality quantitatively by applying percentage to a benchmark. So for example, you can take 5% of profit before tax. Assess based on 5% of profit before tax. So this is an example. Alright? Now then we say that then auditor shall establish performance materiality. So what is performance materiality then?
Now, performance materiality is materiality that is less than the financial statement materiality. Okay, now why do you have a performance materiality? It's because of the risk issue, right? To reduce to an acceptably level the risk of what? Undetected and uncorrected misstatement exceeding the financial statement materiality. Now that's the definition. Okay. Now they ask for concept. Concept is anything, you know, anything. Concept is anything about materiality. It's called concept. For example, I can talk about, I just give you point, example. I can talk about what is the purpose of materiality. Okay? Because you set materiality for a reason, what? So you must have a purpose. So what is it? You can talk about the purpose. Now you can talk about, for example, how do you determine the benchmark? Because here we say profit before tax is an example, but it's not just PBT, right? You can consider the use of turnover, the use of asset, and we discuss what, that there are quite a number of reasons why you're using different benchmark. That's also concept, right? Now, if you think of putting all these things inside, then you have a lot of point in it. And we talk about qualitative materiality. And what are qualitative materiality? That's also a concept, which you can give one or two examples and say that it's considered material, even though the amount is not big, or even though it's not to do with amount, like what, okay? Now, so these are plenty of answer in part A. So you just need to know what is it, write what you know, okay? Now, that is A. Now, we're going to look at B now. Now, the first part of B, 5 marks, actually, you must get 5 marks out of 5 marks. Because the examiner say calculate phi ratio. Okay, calculate phi ratio for both year, which would assist the audit senior in planning the audit. You look at the financial extracts, financial statement extract, and see what ratio can you calculate. You just give phi ratio, like any phi, okay? Now, then B number two, using information provided and the ratio calculated, identify and describe 5 audit risks. Now, she said information and the ratio. That means you can also talk about the risk using the information, not necessarily from the ratio one. Understand? Okay, so you can use the information and talk about the risk. You can use the ratio and talk about the risk. You can use both. So it's quite flexible here in part number two. Now, she just want you to discuss 5 areas of risk. Now, you must talk about 5 risks, like which part you feel is risky, and then the response. The response is what? The procedure. So after you look at the risk, what you're going to do? So what do you think about the audit work now? Okay, and the procedure. Okay, now we read this. So you are the audit senior of Rhino and Co. And you're planning the audit of Kangaroo Construction Co. Just called Kangaroo. For 31st March 2013. Now Kangaroo specializes in building houses. Provides 5-year building warranty to its customer. Now your audit manager has held a planning meeting with the finance director. And he has provided you with the following notes of his meeting and the financial statement extract. Okay, they say Kangaroo has had a difficult year. and the house prices has fallen. As a result, revenue has dropped. So you can see in the extract, 15 become 12.5. In order to address this, the management has offered significantly extended credit term to their customer. They're given longer credit term. However, demand has fallen such that there are still some completed houses in inventory where selling price may be below cost. Now, during the year, while calculating depreciation, the directors extended the useful life of plant and machinery from 3 years to 5 years. So the director has revised the depreciation rate, and this reduced the depreciation charge. Now, the directors need to meet a target profit before interest and tax. So there's a target performance of 0.5 million in order for an annual bonus. And we can see the profit is exactly 0.5. That's scary lah. That means you just qualify for bonus. That means maybe it's not 0.5. Maybe you inflated a bit, make it 0.5, then you get a bonus. Now, in addition to try and improve profit, Kangaroo changed their main material supplier to a cheaper alternative. Now, this has resulted in some customers claiming on their building warranty and for extensive repair. So because you use a cheaper raw material, now you got more problems with defects, more people come and make claim. And to help with the operating cash flow, the directors borrow $1 million from the bank during the year. And this is due for repayment at the end of 2013. So the loan that they borrow in 2013, which is due for repayment at the end. Now, so these are the records that they show to us. Okay. Now, the main thing is a short-term loan actually, correct? Now? Because now it's March. So now it's March. So end of 2013, they must settle. So it's a short-term loan. Now, we see their accounts, they given us the revenue, the gross profit, operating expenses, so the PBIT, so the inventory, receivable, cash, payable, loan. Okay, now, so you just need any five ratio, any five, also correct on your answer. Okay, now, so you just calculate and see. Question 3B. 1. The financial ratio.
Okay, so the first one you give them is the
definitely GP margin of current, okay? So 5.5 divide 12.5, 7 divide 15, and 46.7. Okay. Then you can give them the PBIT or operating margin, okay? So the PBIT is 0.5 and 4%. 12.7. So the P&L gone already. Okay, done already. Alright. you can work out operating expense over sales ratio if you want. Okay, operating expense over sales ratio. That's also another ratio. Okay, to see what's the proportion of your spending over your revenue. Now from the balance sheet figures, we have inventory, receivable, payable. Now surely you can calculate the three working capital ratio already, right? Inventory day, receivable day, payable day, right now? Okay, so inventory day. So how many days for your inventory? Now they give us the balance is 1.9. So the cost of sales is 7 times 365 days, so it comes to about 99 days. Okay. Then for 2012, your inventory is 1.4, then cost of sales is 8, so it's about 64 days. Receivable days. Right, so the receivable days is 3.1, 12.5 times 365, sorry, so it's 91 days. Then 2/15. That's 49 days. Now payable days. Ratio measuring liquidity. So if I say current asset divided by current liability, current asset is inventory, receivable, and your cash. So it's 5.8. Now current liability must include the loan. The loan is payable end of the year. So it's 2.6. So 5.6 over 2.6 is about 2.2 to 1. For 2012 is 1.4 plus 2 plus 1.9, so it's 5.3 to 1.2. well, that's 4.4 to 1. So 5 marks in hand already. Alright, now we move on and look at risk. Bring 5 risks from the case study. Any 5 problem. Okay? And then talk about what you're gonna do. Okay. So methods that increases the risk, and then what is your response? All right, now they talk about credit term, okay? Management has extended credit term. Receivable days have increased from, if you see the ratio, 49 to 91 days. Now these increases concern of whether debts are recoverable. But remember, I've said to you already, if you need to talk about risk, of course we know they're asking of risk of MM. If they're asking a risk of MM, you must explain to how it affects your financial statement. If you don't bring to how it affects financial statement, then your answer is not explaining the risk. So what's the issue that we see? The issue will be the doubtful debt, right? The allowance, right? Okay. So if they are irrecoverable, management shall make allowance for it, or else receivable balance would be overstated. We see that as the first issue. So there's one risk idea. Okay, so you know that this is an issue, what you're gonna do? So when you do the audit, you must focus on reviewing receivable, right? Recoverability. Okay? So focus on testing for irrecoverable debts, which include testing subsequent receipt and review receivables aging. Discuss with management on long or old debts regarding its recoverability. So it's like you discuss about how to audit that term. But in very brief, you just mention on the problem. Okay, then the case mentioned about houses price falling, that there are completed houses in inventory are below cost. Okay, so that's the second issue here. Now management indicated incident of inventories realizable value be low cost. Now,
inventory days. Have increased from just now we calculated $64 to $99, which indicates increase of inventory. Being overstated.
Now that's the problem in your account. Overstating your inventory balance.
Then what do you do now for the audit? Now this is auditing inventory valuation. So we should review subsequent sales. To assess that inventories are valued at the lower of cost and NRV. Okay, there's one response, subsequent sales to test the NRV. Okay, then the next paragraph, they mention about changing their depreciation rates. Okay. So the rates have changed, depreciation has reduced. I think this you can discuss together if you want with the profit estimate of $500,000, because probably they might have think of using this to manipulate the profit. Alright, so you can talk about this together. Okay, now, so management has a profit target of 0.5 million in order to get bonus, and this increases risk of management manipulating. The financial result. Okay. Coincidentally, directors revise the economic useful life of machine to 2 years. Depreciation charge. Okay, now an unreasonable accounting estimate would mistake financial statement. So it's 2 issues lah, but since I look at this quite close, we can discuss this together. Okay. Now, so my response is to consider the potential area of financial statement where management can manipulate them to inflate the profit. Okay, now
if you know those area, then you might have to focus more on such area. For example, be more alert, exercise professional skepticism. In terms of the accounting estimates, we should discuss with the director for their justification to revise the economic useful life. Okay, so why they think that the life is 5 years? Why is it longer? Alright, and you can consider match this, okay? Assess it with maybe the industry practice, or if there's any asset replacement policy of kangaroo. Alright, now there's a issue about the useful life. Alright, now they talk about things like changing material to cheaper alternative. Okay, now they also mentioned about customers claiming. Alright, now these are all examples of issues that we see that you have warranty provision. Okay, now, so the company has switched to cheaper material supplier. Increasing problem of building defects, thus the claims from customers. Okay, now, so a warranty provision is necessary. They give 5 year warranty, okay? And likely that amount is higher now. So again, an unreasonable estimate of the provision would mistake financial statement, especially if they have intention to manipulate profit. So they probably will try to reduce it. So what you're going to do now is you probably have to review the claims from the customer. Review the level of claims from customer and assess the reasonableness of the provision made by Kangaroo for 2013. Now, since this is something you do now, you can always compare it with the past, right? Okay, so we should compare this to the provision made in 2012. Okay, one last ratio to comment. Okay, probably I can consider look at the working capital ratio. Alright, now you see they have a 64 days inventory and 49 days receivable for 2012, and they have 55 days of payable. Now they have a 99 days of inventory and 91 days of receivable. So both also increase substantially. But they only carry a 83 days of payable. So we can see that the payables have increased, but not so much. Okay. So where do you finance then? Now you must have financed from somewhere, correct? Right? Okay, so you tell me you finance from your cash. But cash go down already, ma. Okay? So the loan that you have borrowed is just 1 million. So now where is the money coming from? So the figure doesn't match. So in that case, I suspect there is a risk of the liability being understated. Okay? So probably they have not recorded. So maybe there's a risk. So we look at the last risk here is payable days. Now payable days for 2012 were for 55 days, while in 2013 were 83 days. Now, considering the increase in receivable and your inventory, the rise in the payable days was inconsistent, too low. So this could indicate risk your payables being understated. So we should test subsequent payments to supplier to record, to detect unrecorded purchases or liability. Okay, now for payable balances that disagree with supplier statement, have them reconcile and test validity. Of the reconciling item. Move on, question 4. Alright, now 4A, the first 10 marks. Okay, it's another theoretical area. The examiner say, describe 5 types of procedure for getting evidence, and for each procedure, describe an example relevant to auditing property plant equipment. That means you talk about inspection, observation, confirmation, anything, okay? So you just talk about 5 that later you can talk about what you do to audit property plant equipment. Okay, so you want, you can put it in a table. The procedure applied to audit of PPE. Right, I think inspection definitely must come in, right? Physical inspection. Okay, to perform a physical examination of asset, okay, or inspection is to inspect or examine records or document generated internally or externally. Now, there are 2 types of inspection we say before, okay? So if you apply to audit a PPE, example is we will perform a physical inspection of tangible asset to test its existence. Okay. Recalculation. Also a procedure, right? So what is recalculation? It's about checking mathematical accuracy. Okay? And the standards say you can do it manually or electronically, where it can be manually or electronically performed. So if I talk about audit PPE, then I can recalculate the depreciation charge, because I want to know whether the depreciation is calculated correctly or not. So I recalculate the depreciation charge. based on the depreciation rate and the cost of the asset. Okay, that's recalculation. The inquiry, also a very common way of getting evidence. So inquiry. So what is inquiry? Seeking information from knowledgeable person. Correct, no? So it's about seeking information from knowledgeable person, both internal, external to the entity. It can be formally in written form or informally by oral inquiry. So inquiry is, you can write, you can ask verbally, it's all called inquiry. It can be inside, it can be outside. Okay. So what example of things that you can inquire? Anything that you discuss with management. Okay, for example, I can inquire management on the review of impairment of tangible asset, okay, or seeking written representation is also inquiry, ma. Because you ask them to write to you, so when they write to you, their inquiry is formally written, ma. Okay, so seeking written representation from management over the estimates of your economy useful life. That's also example of inquiry representation. Okay, external confirmation. Okay, so what's external confirmation? Is to get response directly from third party, right? So to obtain a direct written response from a third party to auditor. Okay, this is called external confirmation. So what kind of things that we can do an external confirmation? For example, maybe to the bank. Okay, now confirming with bank or maybe with lawyer over their custody of any ownership documents over the tangible asset. Okay, you may have, for example, your grant, your titles that banks or lawyer are keeping safe for you. Okay, at this confirmation. Okay, one last one that you can put in. For example, you want to talk about observation. Okay, you'll use AP, analytical procedure. AP involve evaluation of financial information. Most basically. Through plausible relationship. And the resulting investigation on the unusual fluctuation or the significant deviation review.
Okay, I got no space, so I cut it short, okay?
So when you look at your AP, you're going to study those relationship. For example, you can compare the level of your tangible asset and amount of depreciation charges for current year with the prior year.
Okay, so that can help us to identify if there's any unusual movement, right? So that's the part to do with A. So that's 10 marks, 5 procedure. So the first 5 is theory, and then they ask for asset. So how do you audit fixed asset using the 5 procedure?
Balance 10 mark actually relates to internal audit, okay? But the part B you still can do lah, because part B is about fraud, okay? But C and D is more of internal audit. We're gonna cover that tonight, alright? Now I just read the question and explain roughly to you, okay? They say Bush Baby Hotels operate a chain of 18 hotels located across the country. Now every hotel has bedroom, restaurant, leisure club facility. Now most visitors to the restaurant and leisure clubs are hotel guests, but facilities are open to public. Hotel guests generally charge the cost to their room, but visitors, they make payment directly to the hotel staff. So during the year, senior management noticed there's increased level of cash discrepancies and inventory discrepancies. So they suspect that some employee have been stealing the cash from the hotel. So they are very keen to prevent this from reoccurring. So they want to start internal audit department for fraud investigation. So B, they ask you, actually how internal audit department can help the directors to prevent and detect fraud? Now how do you have an internal audit that can help you to prevent and detect fraud? Now actually that one is just logic, right? So we're talking about control for preventing and detecting fraud. Now you think and see, internal auditors come in, they can help us to evaluate the control weakness and suggest area to improve, thus you minimize the chance for fraud to take place. Correct, no? Because now I'm very sure that the reason why they can do fraud is because the controls are not good. Okay, controls are not good so that people know that where are the loopholes. So you can use internal audit to evaluate the system for you. So after you evaluate, then he will tell you that you must improve on this part and stuff like that. Okay, number two. Now the internal audit can conduct fraud investigation. So they themselves will go and check for you which part that the fraud could have occurred. Okay? Then once you do a fraud investigation, if actual fraud is detected, then action can be taken on the fraudster.
Like you make police report, right? So I can help you to investigate.
And now you think and see, the moment you start to implement all these things, you start to show that as internal auditor, we improve control, we start to punish and report to police to catch a fraudster, then the worker knows, so they scared anyone. So that's why that by the above, employees will be deterred from committing fraud already. Because they're scared, man. They know that what if they do, then they might be caught. So this is the 3 marks, okay? So it's actually very simple. Okay, you don't need to study internal audio, so you can do that. All right. Now B, C, D, I don't want to do. Okay, so I'm going to skip that. Okay, can we turn to question 5? Again, examiner, repeated question. Explain the 5 elements of assurance engagement. Can I know which 5? There are 5 things that you call as assurance. You must have what? Three-party relationship. And the 3 party includes the practitioner, user, responsible party. Okay? Come on. There must be a subject matter. Correct enough. And this is common subject matter that the responsible party prepare, user uses, and then the practitioner evaluate. Now when you want to evaluate the subject matter, you must have what? Criteria. So the criteria is the basis of how we evaluate whether this subject matter is properly prepared or not. Okay, so if you talk about audit, the criteria is your financial, your accounting standard. Okay, and then you must have engagement process, a systematic approach of how you're going to collect evidence and then how you're going to derive conclusion. So that's where this is the framework that you use. So in this case, audit example is the auditing standard. And finally, you must have what? A written assurance report, which is your conclusion. Okay. Now there's a 5 thing. So I just tell you the 5 things. We learned this before. This is also a question we did before also, okay? Now so it's pure repeat, examiner repeated, okay? Alright, now B. 12 marks. Okay, for each of the 2 events above, explain whether financial statements require amendment. And describe the audit procedure to be performed in order to form a conclusion on any required amendment. So you get 6 marks each, 3 marks, 3 marks. Okay. Now, Panda manufactures chemicals, has a factory and 4 off-site storage location for finished goods. Panda's year end was 30th April 2013. The final audit is almost complete and financial statements and audit report are due to be signed next week. Revenue is 55 million. Profit before tax is 5.6 million. Now the reason the examiner give this is you can calculate materiality. Right now, okay? Alright, now the first event. The following 2 events occur subsequent to the year end and no amendments or disclosure have been made so far. Event number 1, defective chemicals. Now Panda undertakes extensive quality control checks prior to dispatch of any chemicals. Testing on 3rd May 2013 found that a batch of chemicals produced in April was defective. Now the cost of this batch was 0.85 million. In its current condition, it can only sold at a scrap value of 0.1 million. The cost of correcting the defects are too significant for Panda's management to consider this an alternative option. So that means you have no choice, okay? Just have to scrap. Now the reason is because of the issue of the chemical problem, the quality defects, which was produced way back in April, okay? Now, event number two, there was an explosion. An explosion occurred at the smallest of the four off-site storage locations on 20th May 2013. Now, this resulted in some damage to inventory and the property plant equipment. The management have investigated the cause and they believe unlikely that they will claim insurance. Management has estimated that the value of the damaged inventory PPE was 0.9 million and that they have no scrap value. Okay, so first of all, we look at event number one. Now, they ask whether you believe that you need to do any amendment, okay? Now, so what's the issue that we see here? Is it adjusting or non-adjusting? Now, the inventory suffered a fall in the NRV, correct not? That is now below cost. Okay, and inventory shall be valued at lower of cost and NRV. Now, the cost of the fall in NRV was due to the quality defects. Occurred during the production run in April. Year end is May. So